Okay, I'd like to welcome our next speaker onto the stage. This is Marion.
Hello.
Hello, how are you?
Good, and you?
Very good, thanks. Good. So, do you want to go ahead and pull up your slides?
Yeah,
Marion
sure.
from DocLib. I took a quick look at the website earlier, and it seems like they're doing some pretty interesting stuff there.
Use my screen? Yeah, good.
Yeah, just going to present.
Okay. Okay, so let's start. Okay, so as Alan just said, I'm Marion. I'm a product manager at Doctolib, and today we will speak about what interoperability means at Doctolib, with the topic from backend to backend API to a better experience with frontend oriented interoperability. Great topic. So at first, what is Doctolib? I'm sure some of you already seen this page, but this is a patient website where you can book appointment with doctors, and you can also book teleconsultation, follow your past and future medical appointment, and share documents with practitioners. But this is only a part of our product, because the main part is an agenda, a calendar for practitioners where they can manage so their appointments, but also organize their workload, communicate with the patient, and yeah, manage administrative information of the patient. As medicine is not only done physically in a practice, everything is also mobile available. Now, if we dig a bit more in the context, how doctors work in a daily life without Doctolib at first. Basically, they have a medical software. In this medical software, there are different bricks, like the agenda, the medical follow-up of the patient, the administrative follow-up of the patient, prescription and billing. So medical stuff, statistic about that, and also sometimes some tools to communicate with the patient. Now, when we add Doctolib in this environment, these bricks are splitted between the medical software and Doctolib. As Doctolib is an expert to administrate administrative information of the patient, but also handle the communication and the calendar, this is done in Doctolib, and there is still some statistics about that for the practitioner. But all the medical stuff are still done in the medical software. So the medical follow-up, statistic, prescription, and the billing. I'm sure you see where I want to go with that. We need interoperability to link the medical software and Doctolib. For that, we will use the patient to do this interoperability, this connection, and that will help the doctor to work in their daily life. Now, interoperability in the health domain is a complex domain with a lot of stakeholders like clinics, hospital, laboratories, pharmacists, and the patient. And that's why an association created a standard to communicate in this health domain. There is two different standards, HL7, so health level 7, 7 for the 7 level of a network, and FHIR, another one based on the HL7. This association, they met regularly to adapt the standard to the news on the health domain. Like, for example, for the COVID, we had probably an update on this standard. Here, you have an example of an HL7 message. Pretty clear, as you can see. This is a message to create a patient in a software. How I know that? Because this is an ADT message, admission, discharge, transfer of the patient, and A04 for the patient creation. So everything is codified. There is a lot of information in this kind of message, but we will focus on the PID part, where patient information, administrative patient information are contained. You can see the last name and the first name of the patient, the birth date, the gender, the address, and communication information like phone numbers. So everything has really a dedicated place in this kind of message. And this is really important in such complex domain. But these rules, this standard, can be read differently depending of the reader. That means everyone didn't understood the standard the same way. And so this is really common to see the phone number not at this place, but at another place in the message. So logically, Doctolib decided to use this standard to build interoperability with medical software in medical structure. But At first, not all medical software have a HL7 bricks on it. Mostly, this is medical software for really big structure like hospital and clinics. So doing interoperability with the standards means that we can do interoperability only with really big medical structure. As I just said, there is really a difference depending on who create and read this message, because everyone reads the standard differently. So Doctolib create an HL7 message, but this is maybe not exactly the format expected by the medical software in the other side. That's why we created a proxy, and the role of this proxy will be really to transform this message in the right format for the reader at the end, so on both sides. This proxy will also be used to dispatch the message between the different medical structure using different medical software, and also handle the transfer protocol in MLLP or HTTP. That means we also need to have a VPN, and so a medical structure that can handle a VPN on their side also. At the end, this proxy became really hard to maintain for us because there is a lot of different transformation to do any depending on the medical structure, a lot of dispatch to do. And so, yeah, hard to maintain at the end. And also, this kind of interoperability was only available for really big structure and not all the environment we wanted to have interoperability. And that's why we say bye-bye to the proxy and decided to use another type of interoperability. That's why Doctolib used the knowledge we own, thanks to this standard, to create an API, an open API, that can be available to other medical software editor, which don't have HL7 bricks on it. That means that we are now able to have interoperability with smaller structure, like just medical practice you have in your city. This kind of API is also secured because we use HTTPS transport. And that means we don't need a VPN anymore. And this is even easier to install this kind of interoperability in smaller practice. What does that mean in real life? So this is really a standard API. Doctolib is completely passive in this part. And the medical software will do get and post. We give the possibility to the medical software editor to choose between HL7 and JSON to do the communication. Most of them prefer to use JSON because, as you've probably seen, this is more readable than HL7 and more understandable just by one look. We synchronize mostly patient and appointment because this is the kind of information we have in Doctolib, and we don't have medical information in Doctolib, so this is not something we can transfer to the medical software. So for a doctor and a patient in real life, what happened exactly? So an appointment will be booked for a new patient in Doctolib by the patient in the Doctolib website or directly in the practice by the secretary or the doctor. That will create a message in the waiting list for us, and the medical software will just do a GET to copy this patient and appointment in the medical software, almost in real time. When the patient will arrive in the medical practice, the secretary or the doctor will check the appointment and the patient administrative information in Doctolib, maybe do some updates that will be copied in the medical software, and change the status of the appointment as in waiting room, for example. That will be transferred also in the medical software. When the patient will arrive in the medical room with the doctor to do the consultation, the doctor will have to go in the medical software, search for the patient, open the patient, and do the medical stuff you have to do, the billing, the prescription, etc. At the end of the consultation, if the practitioner wants to book another appointment for this patient for a follow-up, for example, he will have to go manually in Doctolib, search for the patient in Doctolib, and book an appointment in Doctolib on an available slot. So it works, and doctors were happy with that, but we thought it was not really a perfect usage, and we can do better. We can have a better integration of Doctolib in the medical software and avoid this switch manual between Doctolib and the medical software and have to research the patient again, etc. And that's why we decided to create a front-end oriented interoperability. We'll stop synchronize appointment because most of the times they are not needed, and we just need to synchronize the patient information. And also, this front-end interoperability will give us the opportunity to synchronize what we call in contextual action. So basically, this is switch between Doctolib and the medical software with patient information. So that means we can directly open the patient in the medical software in real time, and there is no need to research the patient in the medical software and the other way around. So we name this type of connector zipper at DoctoLib. So most of the medical software are desktop in the environment, but there is still some medical software that works in web. That means we have to find a solution that works for both. So let's focus on the desktop one at first. So DoctoLib is open on Google Chrome. We created a small Chrome extension, and this Chrome extension will communicate with a little exe DMG file on the computer of the practitioner that will communicate with the medical software, which is done over TCP, and the other way around, obviously. So as you can see, everything is locally installed on the computer of the practitioner. There is no notion of connection to server here. And also, that means that if there is a missing part in this travel, the interoperability will not work. You need really to have DoctoLib and the Chrome extension and the little exe DMG file on the computer and the medical software open to have the interoperability working. If the medical software is not opened, that will not work, and you can lose data. For web PMS, this is even easier. Why? Because you just have to have DoctoLib and the medical software open in Google Chrome, and all the communication will go through the Chrome extension still directly on the computer of the practitioner. We have the same kind of issue. If the medical software or DoctoLib are not opened in Chrome, the connection will not work and you can lose data. So basically, with this kind of interoperability, we have better workflow for the user. We just synchronize needed information, no more appointments, and so that makes everything easier for us. We have an update system for the Chrome extension with the Chrome Store, and for the little DMG.exe file, we created an auto-update system. This is really important when you add some desktop part in your interoperability. Also, for us, this is really a new product, another product with another life cycle of development. But we added some dependency with Google Chrome by doing that, because our extension is on the Google Chrome Store also, and that means the support process is harder for us right now, because everything is on the computer of the practitioner, and if there is an issue, we really need to be with the practitioner in front of the computer to see what happened exactly. Also, the support process is harder because we really need to have everything open at the same time to make the connection work. So here, just a quick video to really illustrate what I just said to you about how it works, and so you can see really the focus switch between DoctoLib and the medical software. So here in DoctoLib, you have an appointment, you have button to switch directly to the PMS in the patient file, and as you can see, you have really an automatic switch, and the patient is already open in the medical software. You don't need to search for it. So after that, we ask to editor to add some button in the medical software to book appointment in DoctoLib. That will create a focus switch directly to DoctoLib, and the patient is already focused, pre-selected. And after that, you just have to click on a slot and the patient is already pre-filled in the appointment you just created. We also ask them to create some other action, like open the patient historic, as now all the appointments are in DoctoLib and no more in the PMS calendar. All the appointment history is in DoctoLib, and so this is really useful for the practitioner to have this possibility to see easily the history of the patient without searching for it in DoctoLib. So now, if we just take a step back, where we stand. DoctoLib is available in different kinds of structure. In practice, medical practice, like the one you have in your city, clinics, hospitals, and healthcare centers. And we have different types of interoperability. We have Zipper, the front-end oriented one, and some back-end one, JSON over HTTPS, HL7 with HTTPS, and the connection with the proxy with HL7 or Fire. If we check the compatibility now, the proxy, as we just said, it works, yes, but this is mostly for really big structure like clinic and hospital and not adapted to practice and healthcare center. The HTTPS one is really compatible with all environments, but in terms of usage, this is not really good. And that's why we went through Zipper. Zipper is really adapted to practice, to small practice, but not to really big structure because of identity monitoring issue. What is the issue with identity monitoring? Let's imagine we are in a clinic, so a really big structure right now. In this structure, we have a practitioner A, client of DoctoLib, and using this front-end connection Zipper. And we have the practitioner B, who is not a client of DoctoDib, and so no connection between DoctoDib and the medical software of these clinics. In the patient base of this medical software, we have two patient files for Jean Dupont. This is a duplicate. We have the one used by the practitioner A with a birth date and a unique identifier, and the one used by the practitioner B with a different birth date and another patient identifier. The role of the identity monitoring owner in this clinics will be to check what information, which birth date is the right one, and to merge the patient file in the medical software to avoid to have duplicates in this patient base. This is really important in clinic, especially when you can have a surgery, for example. Now the identity monitoring owner did the merge and find the right birth date. We have only one patient file for Jean Dupont in the patient base of the medical software now. But here is the issue. The identity monitoring owner did the merge of the patient file and the update of the birth date on the medical software, and it was not sent to DoctoDib because the identity monitoring owner doesn't use DoctoDib, doesn't have the zipper extension and the little exe.dmg file on the computer. That means now we have a difference of birth date in the patient file between the patient base of the medical structure and the one the practitioner A used in DoctoDib. And worse, now there is only one patient file in the medical patient base of the medical software. If the practitioner B decides to change the first name of this patient, now Jean is now Jane. The practitioner B will do that in the medical software, and the practitioner B doesn't use either DoctoDib and the zipper connection. So that will not be sent in the practitioner A DoctoDib patient base. And we have now a worse difference between the two patient files. This kind of issue happens several times every day in this kind of big structure, and more when the size of the structure increases. That's why we found that front-end interoperability is really not adapted to this kind of big environment with a lot of stakeholders. But we wanted to really provide this front-end experience with a really good usage to all kind of structure. And that's why we decide to mix our technology. So do a DoctoLib server to medical software server interoperability, the classic API by HTTPS I presented to you just before, to synchronize patient and appointment if it's needed. That means that if the practitioner B do an update of the last name of the patient, that will be sent to DoctoLib also, not if we have only zipper. And also, we have the front-end interoperability, but just to manage the contextual action I presented to you before, for example, to book an appointment easily, to open the patient easily between DoctoLib and the medical software. That means now we have really a good product in terms of usage. If we go back to our compatibility table, we still have the proxy, complex and heavy, and not really adapted to a small medical structure. We have the HTTPS one, compatible everywhere, but not really good in terms of usage. Zipper, really good usage, but not compatible with big structure because of this identity monitoring issue. And Staple, compatible everywhere and really usage friendly. But you have to keep in mind that Staple is longer to harder to develop than just a zipper or HTTPS connection. You have both parts to do in development. That means when you choose Staple, you have really to take all your environment in account, and maybe only a zipper is needed in your situation and you don't have so much development to do. So to conclude, if we just do a summary of that, one size does not fit all, and you really have to adapt your API style to your need and your context. Here, for example, the cost of development and the environment. So thank you for your attention. Now it's question time, but just before, if you want to know more about DoctoLib, you can check our career opportunities or our tech newsletter just there. Thank you.
Hey, thanks very much, Maren. Looks like you've been very, very busy over the last few years. Yeah. I'd have a question with you regards to, if you're a developer and you want to do, you know, try out these APIs, is that possible? Do you have like a developer portal where they can go to try it out, or how do you normally do that?
We discuss most of the time, we discuss with editors. This is also a commercial relation. So we build a partnership with medical software editors. And mm-hmm. so after that, we have a project manager that will really share knowledge with the medical software editors. And we will work together and we will help them to do the development to really fit the usage.
Okay. I guess that's also because the you have to keep things like very secure as well, I guess,
exactly.
In terms of patient data exactly. and so on. And, you know, Staple came in at the very end there. I didn't quite catch, you know, Zipper we saw, but Staple, how is that different?
It's different because you will have the back-end interoperability. So the patient and the appointment will be synchronized from server to server and in real time. So you don't have this front-end problematic of we can have in big structure with identity monitoring, for example. So this is really the classic one, a classic API. And we just add this this front-end interoperability on the top with this extension and the exe file to have just the contextual action. You will not send patient information through this connection. This is just to manage the switch between the two soft.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I see. And well, last question then. What do you what will you work on next? What's your next challenge?
Oh, good question.
Ah.
Good question. To be honest, since a few weeks, few months, we really think about how we can now continue to improve the usage of our practitioner, because technically we have a product, right? But the goal is really to improve the usage of our client, our user, and this is a study in progress.
Okay, perfect. Well, thank you very much for your time today.